of you have come to hear my story. And here, it's 1950s, all the ladies are in dresses and heels, and I'm wearing pants. But you know, I had to wear pants in my career, climbing on scaffoldings, going into war zones. I should explain, though, that I am dismantling my studio. I am no longer using my typewriters or my cameras. But I saved this one speed graphic, my old comforting standby when all other mechanisms failed. You know, you had to have backup. I would have two cameras around my neck. I'd have 50, 100, 200 of these bubble flash bulbs. Something always went wrong. But let me ask you to step back in time so that I can explain how I became this photojournalist. Well, I used to love going on nature walks with my father in Bound Brook, New Jersey. We would find snakes and turtles. We'd put them under the dining room table. Sometimes I'd go into school with a snake around my neck, a puff adder. I craved attention. My father was an engineer. He was refining multicolor printing. He was a perfectionist. Sometimes I would watch him developing photos in the bathtub. And one time, he took me to a foundry, and I know that my love of machines began. There were machine parts being made out of molten steel, and there was this sudden magic of flowing metal and flying sparks and heat and energy and power. I loved that. His philosophy was, never finish a job until you have done it to suit yourself and better than anyone else requires you to do it. And my mother's mantra was, reject the easy path, do it the hard way. So with those messages burned in my brain, I began Columbia University 1921. But that January, my father died suddenly. I was able to finish the semester. I took a photography course, in fact, from the famous Clarence H. White and concentrated on composition and design. But then I had to make money. I already was lined up to be a counselor at camp for nature and for photography. My mother gave me a used Leica reflex camera with a cracked lens. Actually, that was all right because pictorialism was in vogue. People wanted their photographs to look like paintings, sort of hazy. So I set up my own little studio. I had a dark room. I was selling photographs to the shopkeepers, to the parents, to the staff. And then I'm going to skip the next few years. I went to many colleges. I moved from place to place. It's too confusing. But I had my last two academic years at Cornell, graduated, and while I was there photographing those gorgeous stone buildings and the library tower and through the grill work down to the lake, the professors thought that I should become an architectural photographer. I hadn't thought of that. So they sent me to an architectural firm in New York with my portfolio just to see what they thought, and they said, yes, that would be perfect for you. So upon graduation, I did not go to New York. I went to Cleveland. It was an industrial city just right for me, and some of my family was there. There was Lake Erie, the Cuyahoga River running through it, the terminal tower going up, the high-level bridge. I would spend hours, you know, experimenting with dark and light, with repeating patterns, with abstract patterns, because this is the late 1920s now. Pictorialism is out, modernism was in. So I met a man named Alfred Bemis. He was a clerk in a photography store. He admired my talent, and I admired his technical ability. Soon I had jobs with the Union Trust Bank, with the Chamber of Commerce. But every night I went past Otis Steele, and I wanted to get into that factory. So I wrangled my way into an interview 1927, in front of Mr. Coolis at Otis Steel. Well, I believe there is a power and vitality in industry that makes it a magnificent subject for photography. It reflects the age in which we live, the machine age. And your steel mill is the very heart of the industry with the most beauty, the most drama. Well, it will just be experimentation for now. No, I won't faint. I am not the fainting kind. Well, Mr. Coolis said yes, I could go into the mill any time, and then he went off to Europe for 5 months, which was perfect. Beam and I went into that mill night after night after night. We'd have the snow at our backs and this blistering heat at our fronts, blistering the wood on my camera. I was trying to get the 200-ton ladle pouring out the molten steel, but all of the red and orange, it was all black. And then miraculously, this friend of Beam's on his way through Cleveland to Hollywood came through with flares. And those flares provided the white light for the clarity. And look what I did. Here's the molten steel coming down. And then the 200-ton ladle. And this photograph won first prize at the Cleveland Museum of Art. Now, when Mr. Coolis returned, he offered me $100 a print, almost 10 times what I had been getting, and he ordered more. I wrote in my journal at the time, I want to do all the things that women never do. I want to become famous, and I want to become wealthy. My jobs have increased. I'm hired by an architectural firm. Chrysler and Republic Steel are interested in my work for advertising. I've opened my own studio in the Terminal Tower, and I've changed my name from Peggy White, Margaret White, my father's last name, to Margaret Bourke-White, my mother's maiden name. Has more gravitas, don't you think? And then I received a telegram. Have just seen your steel photographs. Can you come to New York within a week at our expense? Henry R. Luce, Time, the weekly news magazine. Oh. Well, I knew Time. I wasn't interested in photographing political personages. There were all these ore boats and factories and bridges and towers waiting to be photographed. But I suppose a few days in New York wouldn't be so bad, so I was interviewed by Mr. Luce in his rapid-fire delivery. Who are you? What are you? Why are you taking these steel photographs? Is this your hobby? No, this is my profession, and a very serious one. What they were going to do was launch Fortune magazine, which would combine business and industry, and they wanted words and photos to be partners. They wanted me to be their first photographer. So I signed the contract, but not until they agreed to give me half of the year off for my commissioned work and my advertising work. I wrote to my mother, I feel as if the world has opened up to me and I hold all the keys. And then came the crash. Well, 1929, the stock market crashed, but Mr. Luce said we would go ahead. So I moved to New York, and one of my first assignments was to photograph the Chrysler building as it was under construction, going to be the tallest building in the world. And my photographs would prove that. Sometimes I would be out on the scaffolding with the wind blowing 8 feet in each direction with the scaffolding. Three men would be holding my tripod as I got these shots of New York and of the Chrysler building. And when I saw the gargoyles going up on the 61st floor, I said, that is where I will have my studio. And I did. I loved crawling out on the gargoyle. This was taken by Oscar Grabner, the editor, photo editor at Fortune. I was never afraid of heights, never. Well, then, you know, we needed to have a backlog of stories for Fortune, so they wanted me to go out with the writers. I went with Archibald MacLeish to the Elgin Watch Factory, with Dwight MacDonald to Corning Glassworks, and with Mr. Luce himself to South Bend, Indiana. They wanted a whole backstory on South Bend. Of my hundreds and hundreds of shots, I have to show you my favorite one. This is plow blades from the Oliver Childe Plow Factory in South Bend, Indiana, about to be painted red for the farmers. Now, don't you think that machinery is beautiful? Huh. 1930, they sent me to Germany to photograph their rearmaments, which I did. But I wanted to get into Russia, land of tantalizing mystery. Nobody had been across those borders in years, and they had the five-year plan going on. Well, Mr. Luce said, no, we'll cover Germany, we're not covering Russia. Well, nothing attracts me like a closed door. I cannot let my cameras rest until I have pried it open, and I wanted to be first. I had already applied for a visa. When I got to the Russian embassy in Berlin, they looked at my work and said, oh, your pictures will be your passport. But it took 5.5 weeks. I was waiting. I was running out of food and money. Finally, they agreed, yes, this would be good PR. And a whole cadre of men accompanied me to the largest dam, to the collective farms, to the tractor factory. I had 800 shots ready to send them back to New York. But they had to be developed for the sensors. It took the next 36 hours, with the last 6 hours on my knees in front of the bathtub, rinsing out these films and hanging them all over the hotel room on clotheslines. They invited me back the next 2 summers. I have to tell you that people were tired now. Everybody looked shabbier. The women were longing for fashionable clothing, for lipstick. I went home and wrote Eyes on Russia and began giving lecture tours, which began to be a pattern. Whenever I had an adventure, then I would write a book, and then I would go on a lecture tour. You know, in the early 30s, I was doing a lot of advertising work for Goodyear Tire, for Buick, Eastern Airlines. TWA wanted me to photograph their planes going across their routes in America. So they would put me in a small plane, take off the door, and I would lean out with my K20 camera and get pictures of those gorgeous mosaic fields and the forests and the Grand Canyon. You know, back way back then, I had men falling for me left and right, pilots, musicians, writers, but I tried not to get emotionally involved. Oh, then you know, in 1933, I sent a photograph of the new George Washington Bridge to Amelia Earhart, and she wrote back, I have just returned to find your gift of the beautiful span. I think you have caught the spirit of the Washington Bridge subtly and exactly. Thank you for sending it as an example of photographic art and also as a demonstration of what ability lurks with women. Sincerely yours, Amelia Earhart. Well then, 1934, Fortune sent me to the Great Drought in Nebraska. It wasn't called the Dust Bowl until the next year. Well, I had a 5-day deadline. I hired a 2-seater Curtiss Robin airplane. We discovered it was all the way from the Dakotas to the Texas Panhandle, 16 million acres at that point, just blowing away this over-cultivated soil. It was curtains of soil. I wrote for fortune. This year there is an atmosphere of utter hopelessness. Nothing to do. No use digging out the chicken coops or the pig pens after the last disaster because the next one is coming along. No trying to keep the house clean. Vitamin K, they called it. The dust that sifts under the door sills and stings the eyes and grittily seasons every spoonful of food. It gets in the butter and the baby's milk. You know, suddenly it was the people who counted instead of the machinery. With these farmers in the Dakotas, I began to see things in a new light, and I thought I should stop doing some of my advertising work and concentrate on documentary work. Well, the timing was perfect. Do you know Erskine Caldwell? He had written Tobacco Road and God's Little Acre. Everybody thought he was exaggerating wildly the poverty in the South with the sharecroppers. He wanted someone to document it. So that was me. We met in Augusta, Georgia, and it just took a few days to figure out who was going to be boss. But you know, it got so I loved watching Erskine work. He had this quiet, receptive approach. He would wait until the subject revealed his personality, and then he would begin the interview. He was a Southerner. He could mimic the inflection of every state we were in. I was the Northerner. I would stay in the background. And then when things looked comfortable, I would move in with my camera or use a remote. We wrote this book together, You Have Seen Their Faces. And you know, it's very interesting because when the reviews began to come out, it's almost as if the roles were reversed and people began to say, it's as if the pictures tell the whole story and the words are supplemental. So all during that time in Tennessee, Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, Erskine and I fell in love. And that was 1936, and something else major happened in 1936. Mr. Luce decided to launch one more magazine, and this one he would call Life. I was one of the first four photographers. Each of us was sent out on assignment. I was sent to New Deal, Montana, to photograph the Fort Peck Dam as it was under construction. Now, New Deal was a frontier town. It looked like a movie set. It's not even there anymore. You know, there were welders and engineers. There were quack doctors, fancy ladies with boas. Everyone went to the Bar X at night. The bartender put her baby on the bar. I sent all those photos back to New York, and Life sent me a telegram asking what I was doing. I said, don't worry, I have hundreds of shots of the construction of the Fort Peck Dam. Here are the diversion tunnels, for instance. The water will be diverted through these tunnels, and you know, I used to put people sometimes in these massive shots so that you could get the scale. And then, luckily, I was awarded the inaugural cover of Life magazine, November 23, 1936, the Fort Peck Dam. And the men in the inside cover of this magazine, Mr. Luce and friends, wrote, photographer Margaret Bourke-White had been dispatched to the Northwest to photograph the multi-million dollar projects of the Columbia River Basin as only Bourke-White can take them. What the editors got was a human document of American frontier life, which to them was a revelation. You see, what we had created was the new photo essay where pictures tell the whole story. And then they sent me to the Arctic tundra to photograph the new Governor General of Canada as he went about in a steamboat meeting his constituents. And at one of the first stops, a young man came on board and said, "Does anyone suit this telegram? Honeychild, Arctic Circle, Canada. I can't go on. I need you. Come home, Erskine." And at the next stop, "Honeychild, Arctic Circle. I need you. I miss you. Why can't you come straight home?" Well, you know what? We had talked about this often. The very secret of life for me was to maintain in the midst of rushing events an inner tranquility. I had chosen a life that dealt with excitement, tragedy, mass calamities, human suffering, human triumphs. In order to record that and know what I was doing, I needed to have a sense of serenity as a kind of balance. I couldn't have somebody begging me to come home every minute, "Honey child, honey child." Oh, you know, I was invited to the White House, and when I sent my packet of pictures, I said, "Enclosed are photos of the president and his staff, and especially one for the electrician, who said, 'They always promise, but they never keep their promise. I want to be the exception.'" And then Mrs. Roosevelt asked me to come and photograph the whole family at Christmas time. And she sent the most charming note to me: "Artist, genius, Wonder Woman. I have never seen such pictures. They are really extraordinary. I hope we didn't wear you out. Everyone firing questions at top speed. Do come and see us again when you have time to spare, and we can just sit around. Sincerely yours, Eleanor B. Roosevelt." Oh, I have to ask you, do you think Eleanor Roosevelt ever has time to just sit around? I don't think so. Oh, then 1937, the Louisville flood. I was sent to cover the Ohio River had overflowed its banks. All of the people in the low-lying areas had been flooded out and lost everything. I got the last plane in and thumbed a ride on a rowboat to get into town and came upon people in a bread line. Now, we discovered there were hundreds of these billboards all across the country. They were sponsored by the American Association of Manufacturers, trying to tell us that everything is going well. We have the shortest hours, the highest wages. This photograph was supposed to be about the Louisville flood. It has become kind of a marker of the Depression, because we were in the Depression. You know, Farm Security Administration photographers like Dorothea Lange and Arthur Rothstein and very other, Marion Post Wolcott and all kinds of others, went across the country looking for these ironic situations. So while we were dealing with the Depression, Europeans were worried about growing war clouds. Erskine and I went to Czechoslovakia. We were going to write another book together, and came upon immediately thousands of people saying "Heil Hitler." Now, this is Bohemia, Czechoslovakia, and these are Sudeten Germans being whipped up into believing that they are a repressed minority. So in this land of readers, the bookstores are closing, the newspapers are vanishing, the superb liberated theater of Prague has been ordered to close. Erskine and I eluded our escorts, and I was arrested. I have cameras around my neck all the time. They thought I was a spy, but I got out of that. So eventually, we did come back and write North of the Danube, talking about these growing steps toward war. And then you're going to think I'm crazy, but I decided to marry Erskine. I thought if I marry him, maybe he won't be so desperate to be with me every minute. But I made him sign my contract that said he would try to control his mood swings and he would not attempt to take me away from my assignments.
How'd that work?
1941. Now, the Nazis and the Russians had formed a non-aggression pact, and my editor, Wilson Hicks, in New York, wanted me, he knew the Nazis were going to break that pact, he wanted me in Moscow before any other journalist. Now, we could not go through Europe, we had to go all the way around through China. Erskine was coming, he had his own reporting to do. At the end of my speech, you can see the picture I took of Madame Chiang Kai-shek as I went through China. Now, it was 30 days getting across China, getting across Russia, small planes, and finally, we arrived in our hotel directly across from the Kremlin, just as the Nazis were bombing the Kremlin. Now, this picture, I have to tell you, all of this was so spectacularly gorgeous. It was terrifying, and it was so noisy. You just wanted to cower in the subways, but I did not do that because this was my post. So when we saw the inspectors coming to make sure everyone was out of the hotel, we would hide under the bed. Now, I had 5 cameras, 22 lenses, 3,000 peanut flash bulbs, all of my developing equipment. We had films hanging all over the room, tied to and pinned to the curtains. But all this time, what I wanted to do was interview Stalin. Now, finally, Harry Hopkins, Roosevelt's envoy, figured out how I could do it. He allowed me into this room. There was Stalin. He was shorter than I thought and all pockmarked, not at all what you see on these giant posters all over the country. He was stiff. He looked like he was made out of concrete. I said, "Would you like to sit down?" Nothing. Just stared straight ahead. I said, "Remember, I photographed your mother in the early 30s. And the interpreter said, "Your mother, your very mother." Nothing. So I gathered my equipment and suddenly dropped this whole pile of bubble flash bulbs. And as I crawled around picking them up, he burst out laughing. So I grabbed my camera and got this shot with just a bit of a smirk left on his face.
Perfect.
Well, 1942, we were in the war now. Life sent me over to England to photograph our B-17s as they came over. And Erskine sent a telegram asking for a divorce. Well, That was top hills and all of us down in Casino Valley. I filmed all kinds of doctors, medics, and nurses, and patients, and got their stories, and sent all of that back to the Pentagon, like we always do. And they lost that whole portfolio. They lost my things twice. Especially at the end of the war, when everybody was just looting everything. So as the war was winding down, I was sent up in the airplanes to photograph the bombed out cities of Germany. And then I was assigned to General Patton's Third Army when we came upon Buchenwald. Now, Buchenwald had been liberated about 2 days before. These are the only people standing. Everybody else was dead or dying. I made them stand behind the fence for me. General Patton was so incensed that he sent his MPs to a nearby town to bring back 1,000 civilians to see what their leaders had done. They brought back 2,000, all of them covering their eyes. So I covered the war for 5 years and was finally able to get away from the decay of Europe, and life sent me to India to interview Gandhi. Now, Gandhi he was trying to tell his people, if we spin and weave and make our own textiles, we don't have to import from Britain. You see, they were on the threshold of freedom from Britain, 1946. So I went over and came to the secretary for my first interview, and she said, first I would have to learn how to spin. So, deadline or no deadline, I learned how to spin. And then they said I could go in and talk to, well, go in, but not talk to him, because Monday was a day of silence. And he did not like bright light, so I could only use 3 flash bulbs. So I went in, he was very quiet and reading. I took the first shot and it didn't work, I don't know, the humidity or something. So I took the second shot, it flashed, but I forgot to pull the slide. So I took the third shot, and this time I got Gandhi. And you know, his creed is nonviolence, and the spinning wheel is his perfect weapon. I accompanied him to Simla for the freedom talks and back to New Delhi, where he lives with the untouchables. You know, he believes that Muslims and Hindus should live peacefully in India, but Muhammad Jinnah thinks that all of the Muslims should be living in a new area of Pakistan. This brought out clashes and fighting and terrible, murderous things going on. I went back to the United States and did a great deal of research on India, and came back in 47, photographed the gorgeous architecture, the saris, the jewelry, the street people, the untouchables, and the Great Migration. Do you know about that? Hundreds of thousands of families of Muslims moving into Pakistan, and hundreds of thousands of families who were Hindu moving back down into India. He had just come off a 6-day fast. He always fasted to make a statement about violence, and some of his own Hindus were retaliating at this point. So I left that afternoon, and that evening, on his way to evening prayer, he was shot and killed by a Hindu fanatic. Now, you will see in some of the books that I have, I went to South Africa during apartheid, went down all the way into the diamond mines and the gold mines. And then in 1952, there were plenty of excellent photographers in Korea during the Korean War, David Douglas Duncan and all kinds of people. But I wanted to do a human interest story. I begged and begged my editors to let me go. And finally they did. So after scrunching around in the mud for a few weeks, I found the perfect story. A 29-year-old man named Nim Churl Jin, South Korean, had gone into the North Korean army because it paid more. Then he realized his mistake and came back out somehow, and there were soldiers taking him back to his town. So I asked if I could come along. Now, this was going to be kind of embarrassing and touchy because he was a traitor, basically. But he made up with his brother, and then he went to see his wife and their brand new baby that he had never seen. But the story was his mother. You know, if you're a photographer, you want to be at the right place at the right time. And the light was going down, and his mother was in another town out in the fields. So we got in a Jeep and we were zooming over to this other town, and suddenly he stopped the Jeep and went out. And off in the fields, you could see somebody with a stick coming slowly through the fields. And he got out and ran, and then she saw him and dropped her stick, and the two of them ran together. It was very, very touching, a very beautiful picture. And it also proved that I am not a communist. Because, you know, every writer, director, playwright, Hollywood person was being accused of being a communist. I had been to Russia. I was not a communist. I wasn't brought before McCarthy. But you know, when I was in Korea, I noticed my left arm and my left leg were not feeling right. They were very heavy. So after some months in the States, going from doctor to doctor, I have now come to realize I have Parkinson's. I do not have the shaking palsy that so many people have, but I have lost some of my balance. I've been thrusting myself into, exercises. I wad up newspapers. I wring out wet towels. I've been walking 4 miles a day, which is a challenge. You know, I feel like I've been born in the right century, in the right section of decades or even months, because Dr. Irving Cooper is going to operate on my brain. And some of my friends say, well, why are you trying so hard? And I think, well, that's what I did my whole career. The highest praise I ever got from my editors was, Maggie won't take no for an answer. And I won't. So Alfred Eisenstadt, my colleague from life, is going to photograph all of this. I said first, I didn't tell anyone about this for a couple of years, but I thought, this is what we do at life. We tell the truth. We tell what's going on in the world. So what I would like you to do, if you could, is make sure your subscriptions to life are up to date. And then, you know, thank you very much for coming tonight to hear this. You've been very patient. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I hope we have a great Q&A, but first I would like to thank the Vermont Humanities Council, who sponsored this program, and they are a private, nonprofit organization who brings all of these different humanities programs to you. You are a very lucky state, I have to say. And thank you to Chris Kirby, who is not only the public services librarian, but also the cable TV person and everything. So thank you for that. Now, so I will entertain any questions you have, or else I have lots more material to share with you about Margaret.
Are you still alive?
No. Actually, Margaret died in 1971 after 18 years of Parkinson's. She got Parkinson's when she was in her 50s, early 50s. So I'm not still alive. Yes.
Did you ever work in color?
I worked a little bit in color, but you know, first of all, it took a lot longer to develop, and so if they wanted things quick, that wasn't such a good idea. And frankly, I think I'm more talented in black and white. I think almost all of my favorite pictures are black and white. You know, my colleagues, Alfred Eisenstadt, Ansel Adams, all of the people, Carl Meidens, all of my colleagues at Life switched to 35 millimeter small cameras. I stayed with big box cameras way beyond anybody else because I like to compose my pictures and I liked to take my time and set them up. I didn't want to go click, 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 click. I wanted to set up things. And you'll see that in almost all of my pictures. They're very composed. And they're very, well, I can't talk about myself, but I think they're very artistic as well. But there are lots of things that, if you read my autobiography, which I wrote in 1963, you will see one story, and then to slip into Sally Matson now, if you read the biography by Vicki Goldberg, who lives in New Hampshire, you see a slightly different story. Margaret did not mention in any of her dealings while she was alive that she had an early first marriage. She went to member Columbia for 1 year. Then she received a scholarship to the University of Michigan in herpetology. That's what she was going to be, a herpetologist, studying reptiles and amphibians. And she fell in love with a graduate student and got married. He then took her off. She left after. They wanted her to be the photo editor of the yearbook, but she left. He went to Purdue, so she went there and took some courses. Then he went to Case Western. It was a disastrous marriage, 2-year marriage, starting with the mother-in-law joining them, his mother, on their honeymoon. She really told Margaret, you know, I never want to see you again. I mean, she just was horrendous. But Margaret was very, very, very determined. You know, she always wanted to be the best. She tried and tried and tried, but that didn't work. So she never told anyone when she went to Cornell that she had been married, that she's now going to be divorced. You didn't tell people those things, I think. And then another thing she found out when her father died, that she was half Jewish, which she also didn't know. And I think makes some of these pictures really kind of moving when you think she went to Buchenwald and she went to Stalin. And so she had a lot of secrets, which is kind of hard, you know, to go through your life with secrets. So she had two very short marriages, and I think one of my favorite quotes from her, it's not very nice really, but when she was giving a speech to some ladies' group, she said, "The great stumbling block for women is marriage." A husband and children always have a prior claim. The woman photojournalist should not have to go to her assignment with her thoughts torn between two interests, and she should on no account go to work with feelings of guilt. So we're back in the same place, aren't we? There's still plenty of women who feel the same way, but not I, actually. One thing you may not know is that, you know, the RCA building in Rockefeller Center had a huge mural in 1930s of Diego Rivera, and he put Lenin in it, and they told him to take that out, and he didn't, so they tore it out. Her mural went in next, 1935, it was there till 1955, and then they took that out. It was for radio, and I should save the place in one of those books over there. You'll see a sending tower, which she, you know, got down on the ground and took the picture like this of a sending tower. This whole mural was about radio. It was receivers and senders and all of that. The huge Rockefeller Center. was Margaret Bourke-White. She was so famous. And now most, half the people I mention her have never heard of her, which is really sad, I think, because I think she was a very talented lady. Yes?
When she worked for Life, did she mention if her salary was the same as the male photographer?
Well, she didn't mention that. I bet it was, though, because she was one of Luce's stars. When he realized that she was as famous as her pictures, she got all the good assignments. So I don't think she worried about that. She worried about the fact that there was no byline for the photographers. If you look in these old Life magazines, I have a friend, you know, do you know in New Hampshire, the Common Man restaurant has Life magazines. The man collects them and he stacks them up by decade. And so I have a friend who's been going through trying to see if she can find Margaret's, but it's pretty hard to find. But what was I saying? Oh yeah, the byline. So she fought for that and fought for that. You know, they'd have the whole back page with everybody and no photographers, ever. I think it finally came through. So I don't think she had to worry about that. But in her early years, she was struggling. I went to Syracuse University, which I'll tell you why later, to do the research. And boxes of research. And there were all these things how she was in arrears all the time to the Kodak stores and all of that in her early years because she just kept buying equipment and buying everything whether she could afford it or not. So when I went to Syracuse, I said, why are her cameras and her papers here? She went to 5 colleges, but she never went to Syracuse. They said they were, this was in the 60s now, she would have been fairly quite ill by then. They said they were starting a manuscript division and did she want to donate all of her things? And she said yes. So that's where all of her equipment is. What I like now is camera clubs are starting to hire me. The Boston Camera Club, and while I was there, one of Margaret's cousins raised his hand and said he was a cousin and that when she was alive, he would play jacks with her by the hour. And I said, jacks? First of all, I think he was much younger, but it was because of her Parkinson's. She was trying to do that. That just breaks my heart. Yeah.
Could she continue her photography when she had the
Parkinson's? No, that's the thing. Very soon she had to give it up because she lost her balance, number one. And then she had the first operation in 1959, and that went pretty well. But you know, they don't even have these operations anymore. This was a man who thought he had discovered something by accident. He thought if you freeze part of the brain, but anyway, so 2 years later, she had it operated on the other side, and then she couldn't speak very well at all. So she wrote her autobiography, I think probably had someone come and help her. Yes. Yes, sir.
You mentioned several other women photojournalists, Dorothea Lange and Marion Post-Mulligan.
Yeah.
But how extensive was women's participation in photojournalism of that time? Was she just one of a handful, or did she encourage others to follow her?
What she did was influenced others. Let me see if I can find that. Oh, Gordon Parks, she influenced. He saw, you have seen their faces. He read this book and he began doing so much, you know, racial discrimination photography after that. And Robert Frank, who was a Swiss-born photographer. And then Daisy Chappelle, who I wasn't familiar with, was a photographer in the Vietnam War who was killed in Vietnam, actually. She was influenced by Margaret. But there were, because I had to do so much research on this so I would not be completely stupid, there were many, many women photographers way back in the 1800s. But you know, you're never going to hear about them until now when people are finally starting to write about women. But way back in Victorian England, 1815 to 1879, was Julia Margaret Cameron. And then there was Frances Benjamin Johnston, who was a niece of Grover Cleveland, and she documented the rise from slavery, Tuskegee Institute and all. And Jessie Tarbox Beals, who was the first woman staff photographer, Buffalo Inquirer, 1902. So there were, there are many more here. I don't know if I'm going to bore you, but there were a lot of women photographers, actually. It's just that she was very, she liked being important. I think a lot of other photographers stayed behind their camera. She liked to be out in front of her camera a lot and get her face out there too. So she was self-promoting. And you can see that, you know, somebody said after I did this show, well, why don't you show examples of her self-promoting? And I think I do. I mean, she forced her way into the Otis Steele, and she forced her way into Russia, and she, you know, she just said, I'm going on a bombing mission. She asked for it. I'm amazed she survived the things that she did. But also, think how difficult this equipment was compared to what people do today. They send it back on their little phone, and she's carrying all of this and developing equipment. Her luggage was 600 pounds when she went to Russia that time in 1930. 600 pounds. So, one other myth, though, I have to say, and please tell me when it's time for me to stop. She kind of came on the scene as if she came out of nowhere. You know, Mr. Luce said, come and work for Fortune. And it was if, where did this person come from? She's this young girl. She also pretended she was younger than she was. But the fact is, she probably learned a great deal from her father, who was developing photos. She learned a great deal from her first husband. He knew a lot about photography. She learned a huge amount from this Mr. Alfred Bemis. And even in later years, you see some remnants of her giving money to him. So I think that she, you know, was very grateful to all the help she got from him. He set up in her house a rinsing station and all kinds of things like that. So she didn't just come out of nowhere. She had a lot of help along the way. But anyway, I'm happy to answer any more questions, but I don't want to make you stay. Yes?
Are you going to take this wonderful presentation to a larger audience?
Well, I don't know. What my dream is to go to the Cleveland Museum of Art, where she won a prize, to go to the Eastman House, to go to the Portland Museum of Art that did a retrospective of her work in 2005. But you can't imagine, I do my own marketing. It's really hard. You know, I mean, nobody knows who I am. I just have to send them some flyers and hope that they have some idea what I do. It's pretty hard.
What inspired you to do this?
Well, you may know that I've been doing Susan B. Anthony for 10 years. I've been an actress all my life, but now I'm older, so I decided to do something by myself. So Susan B. Anthony was great, but I thought I would do somebody a little more contemporary. When my husband worked in New York City in the 80s, we went to a retrospective of her work at the International Center of Photography, and there were these incredible photographs. And I didn't, you know, think anything about doing a show at that point, but it must be in my brain, you know? So then we moved around a lot, and when I got tired of doing Susan B., which I'm still doing, I decided to do her. And when you start doing the research, then you think, oh my word, nobody knows anything about this person. It's just so astounding. So I hope I can bring her to a lot of people in the near future. Here's another couple of quotes that I love. From Joe Kastner, you were always aware of what she was doing. I didn't mind being conned. She could manipulate men so delicately that they respected her for it. That was from Vicki Goldberg's biography. And Benjamin Sonnenberg, also from Vicki Goldberg, said, "You would have made a swell press agent. You have such an ingenious sense of drama." So, yeah, I loved comments by her other friends, you know. And she didn't really have very close friends because it was all about her. She was just trying to be famous and important and bring people the stories, really. She found that very important. So, but she did correspond with, you should look at all the letters, with Dorothea Lange, with, when she was sick, Maurice Chevalier, and all these people, Faith Baldwin, everybody wrote to her. And because her strength and her wondrous going through that disease was really something to watch, apparently. Yes?
I think we'd all like to know your name.
Oh, I'm Sally Matson. And you were going to write read about me, but you can if you want, or I'll just tell, you know.
You should tell.
All right.
It'll be much more
interesting. All right. So, so I'm from a large family, and mostly people in medicine. But I wanted to do something different, so I went to Northwestern University, studied acting and directing. Unlike Margaret, I did want to get married and have children. So I did that, but kept acting all along. And was very active. Well, I went overseas. 8 of us from Northwestern were chosen to go overseas during the Vietnam War and entertain the troops. So we started in Clark Air Base in Manila and went to Okinawa, Iwo Jima, Korea, you know, Taiwan. It was really something. And then I became an English teacher for a while and then worked at the Powerhouse Performing Arts Center in Connecticut. Anyway, so that's my background. This is kind of fun. I drove all the way up from Massachusetts today through 89, 107, 100. It's very beautiful. It's jaw-dropping. So. And tomorrow I'm driving all the way to New Britain, Connecticut for an afternoon show. I don't usually do that, but how can you say no, you know? It's not like everybody's calling, so.
And where is your home now?
Andover, Mass. Excellent. And I did a show in Andover because the Addison Gallery of Art at Phillips Academy, she visited, gave talks to the students, and sold them some of her photos. So. They gave me a grant so that 2 or 3 organizations in Andover collaborated. So that was fun. So, and who knew that there's a Photographic Historical Society of New England? I'm going to go there. Then they're really going to, I don't know what they're going to ask me, but I'm not going to know half as much because I'm not a really professional photographer. I'm just trying to learn, you know. But. So thank you very much.
Okay.